The following is a free-for-download audiobook available on Google Drive. Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 10, Chapter 59, The Killing of the Demon Naraka. This chapter tells how Lord Krishna killed Narakasura, the son of the earth goddess, and married the thousands of maidens the demon had kidnapped. It also describes how the Lord stole the Parijata tree from heaven and how he behaved like an ordinary householder in each of his palaces. After Narakasura stole Lord Varuna's umbrella, Mother Aditi's earrings, and the playground of the demigods known as Maniparvat, Indra went to Dwarka and described the demon's transgressions to Lord Krishna. Together with Queen Satyabhama, the Lord mounted his carrier Garuda and traveled to the capital of Narakasura's kingdom. On a field outside the city, he decapitated the demon Mura with his disc. Then he fought Mura's seven sons and sent them all to the abode of death, after which Narakasura himself entered the battlefield on the back of an elephant. Naraka threw his Shakti lance at Sri Krishna, but the weapon proved ineffective, and the Lord cut the demon's entire army to pieces. Finally, with his sharp-edged disc, Krishna cut off Narakasura's head. The earth goddess Prithivi then approached Lord Krishna and gave him the various items Narakasura had stolen. She offered prayers to the Lord and presented Naraka's frightened son at the Lord Krishna's lotus feet. After pacifying the demon's son, Krishna entered Narakasura's palace, where he found 16,100 young women. As soon as they caught sight of the Lord, they all decided to accept him as their husband. The Lord sent them to Devadraka along with a great quantity of treasure, and then went with Queen Satyabhama to the abode of Indra. There, he returned Aditi's earrings, and Indra and his wife, Shachi Devi, worshipped him. On Satyabhama's request, Lord Krishna uprooted the heavenly Parijata tree and put it on the back of Garuda. After defeating Indra and the other demigods who were opposed to his taking the tree, Krishna returned with Queen Satyabhama to Dwarka, where he planted it in a garden adjacent to Satyabhama's palace. Indra had originally come to Lord Krishna offering obeisances and begging him to kill Narakasura, but afterward, when his business had been accomplished, he quarreled with the Lord. The demigods are prone to anger because they become intoxicated with the pride in their opulences. The infallible Supreme Lord manifested himself in 16,100 separate forms and married each of the 16,100 brides in a different temple. He took up the required activities of household life, just at like an ordinary person, accepting various kinds of service from each of his many wives. Text 1. King Prickett said, how was Bhaumasura, who kidnapped so many women, killed by the Supreme Lord? Please narrate this adventure of Lord Sharingadamva's. Text 2 and 3. Shukadev Goswami said, after Bhauma had stolen the earrings belonging to Indra's mother, along with Varuna's umbrella and the demigod's playground at the peak of Mandara Mountain, Indra went to Lord Krishna and informed him of these misdeeds. The Lord, taking his wife Satyabhama with him, then rode on Garuda to Pragyotishapur, which was surrounded on all sides by fortifications consisting of hills, unmanned weapons, water, fire, and wind, and by obstructions of Murapasha wire. Purport. The Acharyas have explained in various plausible ways why Lord Krishna took his wife Satyabhama with him. Srila Sridhar Swami begins by saying that the Lord wanted to give his adventurous wife a novel experience and thus took her to the scene of this extraordinary battle. Also, Lord Krishna had once granted the blessing to Bhumi, the earth goddess, that he would not kill her demoniac son without her permission. Since Bhumi is an expansion of Satyabhama, The latter could authorize Christian to do the needful with the unusually nasty Bhaumasura. Finally, Satyabhama had been miffed when Nardamuni brought a celestial Parivjat flower to Queen Rukmini. To pacify Satyabhama, Lord Krishna promised her, quote, I'll give you a whole tree of these flowers, end quote. And thus the Lord scheduled this procurement of a heavenly tree within his itinerary. Even nowadays, devoted husbands take their wives shopping, and thus Lord Krishna took Satyabhama to the heavenly planets to get this a heavenly tree, as well as to retrieve the goods Bhaumasura had stolen and return them to their rightful owners. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti notes that in the heat of the battle, Queen Satyabhama would naturally become anxious for Lord Krishna's safety and pray for the battle to end. Thus, she would readily give permission to Krishna to kill the son of her expansion, Bhumi. Text 4. With his club, the Lord broke through the rock fortifications. With his arrows, the weapon fortifications. With his disc, the fire, water, and wind fortifications. And with his sword, the Murupasha cables. Text 5. With the sound of his conch shell, Lord Gadadhar then shattered the magic seals of the fortress along with the hearts of its brave defenders, and with his heavy club, he demolished the surrounding earthen ramparts. Text 6. The five-headed demon Mura, who slept at the bottom of the city's moat, awoke and rose up out of the water when he heard the vibration of Lord Krishna's Panchajanya conch shell, a sound as terrifying as the thunder at the end of the cosmic age. Text 7. Shining with the blinding, terrible effulgence of the sun's fire at the end of a millennium, Mura seemed to be swallowing up the three worlds with his five mouths. He lifted up his trident and fell upon Garuda, the son of Tarksha, like an attacking snake. Text 8. Mura whirled his trident and then hurled it fiercely at Garuda, roaring from all five mouths. The sound filled the earth and sky, all directions and the limits of outer space, until it reverberated against the very shell of the universe. Text 9. Then with two arrows, Lord Hari struck the trident flying toward Garuda and broke it into three pieces. Next, the Lord hit Mura's faces with several arrows, and the demon angrily hurled his club at the Lord. Text 10. As Mura's club sped toward him on the battlefield, Lord Gadagraj intercepted it with his own and broke it into thousands of pieces. Mura then raised his arms high and rushed at the unconquerable Lord, who easily sliced off his heads with his disc weapon. Text 11. Lifeless, Mura's decapitated body fell into the water like a mountain whose peak has been severed by the power of Lord Indra's thunderbolt. The demon's seven sons, enraged by their father's death, prepared to retaliate. Text 12. Ordered by Bhaumasura, Mura's seven sons, Tamra, Antariksha, Shravana, Vibhavasu, Vasu, Nabashvan, and Aruna, followed their general Prita onto the battlefield bearing their weapons. Text 13. These fierce warriors furiously attacked invincible Lord Krishna with arrows, swords, clubs, spears, lances, and tridents, but the Supreme Lord, with unfailing prowess, cut this mountain of weapon into tiny pieces with his arrows. Text 14. The Lord severed the heads, thighs, arms, legs, and armor of these opponents led by Prita and sent them all to the abode of Yamaraj. Narakasura, the son of the earth, could not contain his fury when he saw the fate of his military leaders. Thus he went out of the citadel with elephants born from the milk ocean who were exuding mada from their foreheads out of excitement. Text 15. Lord Krishna and his wife, mounted upon Garuda, looked like a cloud with lightning sitting above the sun. Seeing the Lord, Bhauma released his Satagni weapon at him, whereupon all of Bhauma's soldiers simultaneously attacked with their weapons. Text 16. At that moment, Lord Gadagraj shot his sharp arrows at Bomasur's army. These arrows, displaying variegated feathers, soon reduced that army into a mass of bodies with severed arms, thighs, and necks. The Lord similarly killed the opposing horses and elephants. Text 17 through 19. Lord Hari then struck down all the missiles and weapons the enemy soldiers threw at him, O hero of the Kurus, destroying each and every one of them with three sharp arrows. Meanwhile, Garuda, as he carried the Lord, struck the enemy's elephants with his wings. Beaten by Garuda's wings, beak, and talons, the elephants fled back into the city, leaving Narakasura alone on the battlefield to oppose Krishna. Text 20. Seeing his army driven back and tormented by Garuda, Boma attacked him with his spear, which had once defeated Lord Indra's thunderbolt. Although struck by that mighty weapon, Garuda was not shaken. Indeed, he was like an elephant hit with a flower garland. Text 21. Boma, frustrated in all his attempts, took up his trident to kill Lord Krishna. But even before he could release it, the Lord cut off his head with his razor-sharp chakra as the demon sat atop his elephant. Purport. According to Srila Vishnu Chakravarti, as Boma raised his invincible trident, Satyabhama, sitting on Garuda with the Lord, said to Krishna, quote, kill him right away, end quote. And Krishna did just that. Text 22. Fallen on the ground, Bomasura's head shone brilliantly, decorated as it was with earrings and an attractive helmet. As cries of, quote, alas, alas, and, quote, well done, end quote, arose, the sages and principal demigods worshipped Lord Mukunda by showering him with flower garlands. Text 23. The goddess of the earth then approached Lord Krishna and presented him with Aditi's earrings, which were made of inlaid glowing gold inlaid with shining jewels. She also gave him a Vaijayanti flower garland, Varuna's umbrella, and the peak of Mandara Mountain. Text 24. O king, after bowing down to him and then standing with joined palms, the goddess, her mind filled with devotion, began to praise the Lord of the universe, whom the best of demigods worship. Text 25. Goddess Bhumi said, obeisances unto you, O Lord of the chief demigods, O holder of the conch shell, disc, and club, O supreme soul within the heart, you assume your various forms to fulfill your devotees' desires. Obeisances unto you. Text 26. My respectful obeisances are unto you, O Lord, whose abdomen is marked with a depression like a lotus flower, who are always decorated with garlands of lotus flowers, whose glance is as cool as the lotus, and whose feet are engraved with lotuses. Purport. Queen Kunti offered this same prayer, which is found in the first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, chapter 8, text 22. The synonyms and translation given here are taken from Srila Prabhupada's rendering of that text. We may also note that although Kunti's prayer occurs early in the Bhagavatam, she offered it many years after the incident described here. Text 27. Obeisances unto you, the Supreme Lord Vasudeva, Vishnu, the primeval person, the original seed. Obeisances unto you, the omniscient one. Text 28. Obeisances unto you of unlimited energies, the unborn progenitor of this universe, the absolute. O soul of the high and the low, O soul of the created elements, O all-pervading supreme soul, obeisances unto you. Text 29. Desiring to create, O unborn master, you increase and then assume the mode of passion. You do likewise with the mode of ignorance when you wish to annihilate the universe, and with goodness when you wish to maintain it. Nonetheless, you remain uncovered by these modes. You are time, the pradhan, and the purusha, O Lord of the universe. Yet still you are separate and distinct. Purport. The word Jagata in the third line of this verse indicates that the functions of creation, maintenance, and annihilation are here mentioned in a cosmic context. The word Utkatam indicates when a particular function is being carried out, whether universal creation, maintenance, or annihilation. The particular material quality associated with that function becomes predominant. Text 30. This is illusion that earth, water, fire, air, ether, sense objects, demigods, mind, the senses, false ego, and the total material energy exist independent of you. In fact, they are all within you, my lord, who are one without a second. Purport. The earth goddess in her prayers directly touches upon the subtleties of transcendental philosophy, clarifying that although the Supreme Lord is unique and distinct from his creation has no independent existence and always rests within him. Thus, the Lord and his creation are simultaneously one and different, as explained by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu 500 years ago. To say that everything is God without any distinction is meaningless, since nothing can act like God. Dogs, shoes, and human beings are hardly omnipotent or omniscient, nor do they create the universe. On the other hand, there is no real sense in which all things are one, for everything is part of the same supreme absolute reality. Lord Chaitanya has given a very useful analogy of the sun and the sun's rays. The sun and its sunshine are one reality, for the sun is the celestial body that shines. On the other hand, one can certainly distinguish between the sun globe and the sun rays. Thus, God's simultaneous oneness and with and difference from his creation is the final and satisfying explanation of reality. All that exists is the Lord's potency, and yet he endows the superior potency, the living beings, with free will so that they can become responsible for the moral and spiritual quality of their decisions and activities. This entire transcendental science is clearly and rationally explained in the Srimad Bhagavatam. Text 31. Here is the son of Bhaumasura. Frightened, he is approaching your lotus feet, since you remove the distress of all who seek refuge in you. Please protect him. Place your lotus hand, which dispels all sins, upon his head. Purport. Here, the earth goddess seeks protection for her grandson, who has been frightened by all the terribly violent events that just took place. Text 32. Shukadeva Goswami said, thus, entreated by Goddess Bhumi in words of humble devotion, the Supreme Lord bestowed fearlessness upon her grandson and then entered Bhaumasura's palace, which was filled with all manners of riches. Text 33. There, Lord Krishna saw 16,000 royal maidens, whom Bhauma had taken by force from various kings. Purport. Sridhar Swami provides evidence from the sage Parasara, as quoted from in the Vishnu Purana 529.31, to the effect that there were actually 16,100 royal maidens imprisoned in Bhauma's palace. Kanyapure sa kanyanam soda satulya vikrama sata di kani dadrishe sahasrani mahamate. Quote, within the maiden's quarters, O wise one, that lord of unequaled prowess found 16,100 princesses. End quote. Another relevant verse from the Vishnu Purana 529.9 is as follows. Deva siddha suradinam nripanam cha janardana hritva hi so shurakanya ruroda nijamandire. Quote, the demon Bhaumasura kidnapped the unmarried daughters of demigods, siddhas, asuras, and kings, O Jarasandha, and imprisoned them in his palace. Text 34. The women became enchanted when they saw that most excellent of males entered. In their minds, they each accepted him, who had been brought there by destiny, as their chosen husband. Text 35. With the thought, quote, may providence grant that this man become my husband, end quote, each and every princess absorbed her heart in contemplation of Krishna. Text 36. The Lord had the princesses arrayed in clean, spotless garments and then sent them in palanquins to Dwarka together with great treasures of chariots, horses, and other valuables. Text 37. Lord Krishna also dispatched 64 swift white elephants, descendants of Ayurveda, who each sported four tusks. Text 38 and 39. The Lord then went to the abode of Indra, the demigod's king, and gave Mother Aditi her earrings. There, Indra and his wife worshipped Krishna and his beloved consort Satyabhama. Then, at Satyabhama's behest, the Lord uprooted the heavenly Parijata tree and put it on the back of Garuda. After defeating Indra and all the other demigods, Krishna brought the Parijata to his capital. Text 40. Once planted, the Parijata tree beautified the garden of Queen Satyabhama's palace. Bees followed the tree all the way from heaven, greedy for its fragrance and sweet sap. Text 41. Even after Indra had bowed down to Lord Achyuta, touched his feet with the tips of his crown, and begged the Lord to fulfill his desire, that exalted demigod, having achieved his purpose, chose to fight with the Supreme Lord. What ignorance is there is among the gods? To hell with their opulence. Purport. It is well known that material wealth and power tend to produce arrogance, and thus an opulent life can often be the royal road to hell. Text 42. Then the imperishable Supreme Personality, assuming a separate form for each bride, duly married all the princesses simultaneously, each in her own palace. Purport. As Srila Sridhar Swami explains, here the word yata indicates that each marriage was duly performed. This means that the entire company of the Lord's relatives, including his mother Devaki, appeared in each and every palace and attended each and every wedding. Since all these weddings took place simultaneously, this event was surely a manifestation of the Lord's inconceivable potency. When Krishna does things, he does them in style. So it is not astonishing that the Lord simultaneously appeared in 16,100 wedding ceremonies taking place in 16,100 royal palaces, accompanied in each palace by all his relatives. Indeed, this is the way one would expect the Supreme Personality of Godhead to do things. After all, he's not an ordinary human being. Srila Sridhar Swami further explains that on this particular occasion, the Lord manifested his original form in each of his palaces. In other words, to take part in the wedding vows, he manifested identical forms, prakash, in all the palaces. Text 43. The Lord, in performer of the inconceivable, constantly remained in each of his queen's palaces, which were unequaled and unexcelled by any other residents. There, although fully satisfied within himself, he enjoyed with his pleasing wives, and like an ordinary husband, carried out his household duties. Purport. The word atarka krit is significant here. Tarka means, quote, logic, end quote, and atarka means, quote, that which is beyond logic, end quote. The Lord can perform krit, that which is beyond mundane logic and hence inconceivable. Still, the Lord's activities can be appreciated and understood to a significant extent by those who surrender unto him. This is the secret of bhakti, loving devotion to the Supreme Lord. Srila Sridhar Swami comments that the Lord was always at home, except for when he had to go out to do ordinary household duties. And Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti points out that since in the Vaikuntha planets, Lord Narayan enjoys with only one goddess of fortune, and in Dwarka, Krishna enjoys with thousands of queens, Dwarka must be considered superior to Vaikuntha. In this regard, Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti also quotes the following passage from the Skanda Purana. Shodha Shaiva Sahasrani Gopyas Tar Ra Samagata Hamsa Eva Mata Krishna Paramatma Janardana Tasya Yita Shaktayo Devi Soda Saiva Prakirtita Chandra Rupi Mata Krishna Kala Rupas Tuta Shmita Sampurna Mandalata Sham Malani Soda Shikala Soda Shaiva Kala Yashu Gopi Rupa Varangane. Ekai Kasashtasambina Shahashena Pratak Pratak. Quote, at that place, 16,000 gopis were assembled with Krishna, who is considered the supreme, the supersoul, the shelter of all living beings. These gopis are his renowned 16 potencies, O goddess. Krishna is like the moon. The gopis are like its phases, and the full contingent of gopis is like the full sequence of the moon's 16 phases. Each of these 16 divisions of gopis, my dear Varangana, is subdivided into 1,000 parts, end quote. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti further quotes from the Kartika Mahatmya section of the Padma Purana, Kaishor Gopya Kanyas Ta Yauvane Raja Kanyaka, quote, those who were the daughters of cowherds in their early youth became royal princesses in their maturity, end quote. The Acharya adds, quote, therefore, just as the Lord of Dwarka is a plenary expansion of the supremely complete Lord of Sri Vrindavan, so his principal queens are full expansions of his supremely complete pleasure potencies, the gopis, end quote. Text 44. Thus, those women obtained as their husband, the husband of the goddess of fortune, even though great demigods like Brahma do not know how to approach him. With ever-increasing pleasure, they experienced loving attraction for him, exchanged smiling glances with him, and reciprocated with him in ever-fresh intimacy, replete with joking and feminine shyness. Text 45. Although the Supreme Lord's queens each had hundreds of maidservants, they chose to personally serve the Lord by approaching him humbly, offering him a seat, worshiping with him with excellent paraphernalia, bathing and massaging his feet, giving him pan to chew, fanning him, anointing him with fragrant sandalwood paste, adorning him with flower garlands, dressing his hair, arranging his bed, bathing him, and presenting him with various gifts. Purport. Thus end the purports of the humble servants of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, to the 10th canto, 59th chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam, entitled The Killing of the Demon Naraka.